Welcome back to Meet the Authors. So glad you could invite us into your home for this segment of Meet the Authors. Today we have Harry Miller. Harry Miller is an author with his first fiction book out. So Harry, welcome on our show.
Hi, thanks for having me.
So glad you could come. And you have a new book, a new novel, a novel about 17th century China. Show it to the camera like you're doing. And here's the title. It's called Southern Rain, a novel of 17th century China. Tell us about your book.
Well, it's the story of a dreamy guy and a very strong woman who struggle to find freedom and get together, and while the whole world is kind of collapsing around them, they have a frustrating time of it.
A dreamy guy and a strong-willed woman.
Yes.
That's great characterization. I love that. So the world is collapsing around them. What's going on in 17th century China as this book is going?
A lot of things are going on. People are not too happy with one another, but it all ends up with the Manchus conquering China. So that's the main political event that the story takes place in front of.
What part of China are they in?
They spend most of the time in South China, in Nanjing. I don't know if you've heard of it. And they sail down the Yangtze River to try to get away from various people who are trying to do them harm. But they also go up to Beijing for a while, too.
Okay. Up to Beijing. That's not on the Yangtze River at all.
No, they have to go on the Grand Canal up to Beijing. So there's a lot of boat travel in this book.
Okay. And so you lived in China. You lived in, well, Taiwan is a form of China. When was that?
I lived in Taiwan from 88 to 92 after college. But I have been to China many times. I've been to Japan a few times. And I wanted to, I was able to incorporate a few things about living in Asia into the book, like witnessing fireworks and weddings and stuff like that. Every time I have to write about a wedding or a fireworks celebration, those personal experiences came in handy.
Yeah, I bet. That's so funny because we think of China and all the fireworks going on in the 17th century. That will bring a lot of real-life feels into it. Speaking of which, you've got this cute little Chinese outfit on.
It's very comfortable, so I even wore it to school today.
Great. And in school, you're a professor at Alabama.
At South Alabama.
South Alabama. Is that in Mobile?
Yes, it is. University of South Alabama. I'm in the history department. I do Asian history there.
Ancient history?
Asian history.
Asian history. Okay.
Some of it is ancient, but
yeah,
it's
ancient,
all
Asian.
It's all
so
Asian.
It's modern Asian history. Mm-hmm. All right, well, that's good. So you have actually, this is your first novel, but you're telling me you'd written some nonfiction. Tell me a little bit about that.
I wrote three nonfiction academic books. That's what academics do.
Yes.
And I wrote them to be as exciting as possible, but they cost like $85, and I don't think everybody can go out and pick up a copy. So I wanted to get my feet wet in fiction, and I'm glad I did. It was a lot of fun to write, and I think it came out okay. I'm waiting for what the readers have to say.
Yeah, I guess so. And it just came out, you said, this month, right?
It really did. It just came out New Year's Day.
Nine days, guys, by the time when this is being filmed. Well, that is wonderful, and it's a beautiful book. I love the cover.
The cover is actually a 17th century Chinese painting.
Yeah.
And the folks at Earnshaw Books, they published it, and they did a fine job putting it together.
Okay, and professionally published over there. So. How much is your book?
It's listed for like 18 or 19 bucks on Amazon, and I don't know how they're going to do it at a bookstore. I don't know that much about marketing, but that's how much it costs.
It's on ebooks too.
You can get a Kindle version on Amazon. That's
right. Great. So the book is wonderful. I've read a few of the chapters on this book, and a few of the pages. It's just the words flow and the images are so dynamic and really get a feel for that culture. So I'm hoping now that you'll read us a little bit of the book.
Well, I'll just start in at the beginning. It's Chinese New Year's Day, and people are doing a lot of fun and dangerous things with fireworks, which is something I remember I told you from when I was in Taiwan. So this would be in the year corresponding to 1644. It's probably around February. Half the city's population are setting off firecrackers to the delight of the other half. In groups of young and old, they hang clusters of the paper-wrapped cylinders like bunches of red bananas from the eaves of temples and taverns. With the touch of an incense stick, the fuse commences to hiss and everybody scatters. If someone chances to round the corner unawares, on his way to visit relatives, he comes abreast of the little bombs the moment they begin to explode and finds himself engulfed in a thundering maelstrom. His chest thumps like a kettle drum hammered by madmen. He flails his arms about his head and staggers away as the crescendo continues, a blur of incandescence hanging in the air near which he passed, casting billows of smoke heavenward. Then, as the last charge on the string gives up its ghost and the echo rolls over the city and disappears into the hills, the celebrants clap and jump for joy, and even the rattled pedestrian grins and waves, signifying no hard feelings. He, too, is enjoying himself. In addition to the hanging clusters, some firecrackers can be thrown, and some are miniature rockets. Explosives of these sorts transform Nanjing streets and alleys into gauntlets of spark-trailing missiles, airbursts, and groundbursts. Young boys, in particular, are fond of launching pocket rockets from their hands to watch them ricochet off buildings and passersby. Their favorite targets are peddlers on donkey carts because they pretend nothing is happening. They go right on hawking their snacks, steam buns, dumplings, while projectiles bounce off their bellies or lodge in the folds of their robes, sending sparks cascading from their torsos. The pinnacle of fun is to toss a cherry bomb into the street, timed to explode when a cart passes over it. There it lies, its fuse sizzling, while, say, the noodle man approaches, crooning thick noodles, thin noodles, sesame paste, black bean paste, and just as his cart reaches it, bang, off it goes in a cloud of sulfur. Both man and beast jolt from the concussion but emerge unfazed, the peddler resuming his hawking, the donkey his hauling, showing no sign of distress. Onlookers beam, and the young pyrotechnicians make ready the next barrage.
How wonderful. What a great section. Really comes alive with that. I went to China myself one time, and wow. I remember walking down the street and little hot muffins. I have a picture on one of my books about me eating a hot muffin. Uh-huh. It's like 10 cents, and it was so delicious. I love that.
It is, and no one was shooting firecrackers off you.
They were not shooting firecrackers at me, no. Uh-huh. This is wonderful. And in the back of your book is all these references to the history of the time and your sources.
Right. Well, I tinker around in history. That's what I do for a living, so I just thought I'd put it all together in a new form, a fictional form. So I've got lots of poems and stuff in it, and I had to give credit for them. Folks are interested where they come from, they could find the sources.
It's a lovely book. Harry, thanks for coming on.
Thank you so much.
It was a pleasure having you on our show and hearing about your delightful book.
Thank you.
We undid tyranny. We undid callousness. Hopelessness. We undid evil and evil's evil twin. We've come a long way. We undid impossible and impossibly impossible.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
We undid indignity and carelessness. Just look at all we've undone. Certainly, we can undo overwhelming. It's time to undo climate change. Undo your part. There's a simple, bipartisan solution to climate change Congress needs to hear about. Go to undoyourpart.com.